And we give honor to God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the comforting Holy Spirit. It is good to be here on the second Sunday in May. And we want to say happy, 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 happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. Amen. 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 I was glad when they said unto me, and the house with the name attached, First Baptist Church. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And second Sunday, our youth help us with service. And what more special day than our youth to help us on Mother's Day? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to ask now Haven Coleman to come with our prayer and Adora Torres to come with our scripture, 2 Kings 4, 22 and 30. That is 2 Kings 4, 22 and 30. Now, Haven also did a wonderful job at Sunday school.
us in life, a mother's love and tenderness is the greatest of them all.
Now, Lord.
I thank the Lord for a wonderful mom that she received her heavenly wings back in 2018. And I just want to say, I love you, Mom.
Bless your heart.
Also, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. God has really blessed us with some great mothers.
Certainly.
And at this time, we have the youth department that will come with their Mother's Day salutations.
All right.
Amen.
Youth, will you please come?
I think we'll start with Brother Kinder. So if you come on back. This is Brother Kinder. I just want to say thank you to my mother. Happy Mother's Day to everyone.
All right. Here it is.
Caring, generous, and loving. She is the nicest grandma I've ever had.
All right.
Whoever will. That it, Ms. Kelly?
That's it. Thank you.
Amen.
All right, then. Let's come on with our dance, our liturgical dance ministry, while they're already down here and ready to go. Our sound man / utility man. Thank you, brother. All right. Lord, bless the Lord.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. Amen. Come on, come on, give up some love. Come on, give it up. God bless your heart. Amen. What a blessing. While they're getting situated, let me say how grateful I am again to have each and every one of you. And we thank the Lord. Oh, Raymond, wake up, Ray. Get on the drum. Raymond over there. And always missing Mama, like the rest of us, not quite like the rest of us do, even more so than we do. But we thank the Lord for giving us strength. I think most of us can say that our mothers were, or they are, very special to us. Yes, yes. Amen. Yes. Yeah, yeah. Amen. Amen. Now let me ask if there's anyone else here that want to just share a word about your mother, and whether you're younger or old, it doesn't matter.
I would love to, Pastor.
Yes.
If you understand your son. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I would love to truly, it is a blessing just to, you know, I look back over the days and hold my mom. To me, was the best mom in the world. Yeah. I know I was said it, but to me, she was the best mom in the world.
Yeah.
To my somebody who cooked, Lord have mercy, she's done to know. The woman who cooked. So I do miss those Sunday dinners, and I miss just her sitting on the porch and coming down, like she's drinking her cold glass of ice water. Most of the time, mom would sleep on that porch.
Yeah.
So they're like, mom, you sleep? No, I'm not sleeping. No, I'm just resting my eyes. Right. She always say that. Oh, I'm resting my eyes. No, mom, you sleep. And she always had the Bible in her lap. Mm-hmm. So she always kept the word in her heart. So I miss my mom.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to hold the tears back. Lord, ooh, Jesus.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
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 I miss that woman so much.
Yeah.
When you want to go down to 1673 Lane and talk to them, you can't no more.
Yeah.
No matter how many years went by, that feeling is still there.
Yeah.
I miss that lady. I'll forever have her right here in my heart. Mama had her. She wrote to me in 1978. And I was starting college, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And this, I put it like, I was in culture shock. I never in my life had seen some of the stuff that I saw in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. So I wrote Mama. I was confused. And we were brought up during that day, when you were in school, you were in school. And if you were in class, you were in class, and it didn't depend on whether or not the teacher was there. You were in class.
Certainly.
And in college, I saw people walking out of class after 10 minutes because the professor wasn't there. And I'm like, so some other things. So I wrote Mama. And told her I was confused, I didn't understand what was going on. And Mama wrote me back and she said, you are in a different world, a different society. Your challenge is to adapt as much as you can. And then she said, but save some money because you need to get home for Christmas and Thanksgiving. Yes, ma'am. But I share that with you to say, I know this is the age of electronics.
Sure.
But parents, take the time to write your child a letter.
Yeah.
Mama wrote that in 1978, and I still have it. It's still dear to my heart. I still go back to it for the advice.
Yes.
Forget this electronic stuff. Give your babies something they can hold on to, that they can put in their hand and look at, just like God gave us the word to put in our hand and that we can look at. Yes, it's on my heart, as God said, put the word in right on your heart, but it helps to have something in your hand.
Good morning, I just want to say, Happy Mother's Day. I am so thankful and blessed to still have my mom.
Amen.
I tell you, it's a challenge right now, but I wouldn't miss it. Man, day of it.
Amen.
So when you still have a mother living,
yeah,
you
gotta see it.
Praise her.
Amen.
Thank God that she's here each and every day that she's here. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for baptism and being that father on the 103rd birthday.
103.
Wow.
Praise God.
Brother going near to the young lady.
Oh, yeah.
I'd like to say about my mother. My mother is a very strong woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she's had cancer 3 times, mm-hmm. breast, throat, amputation of both of her legs. And if I, from that, cannot see the grace of God, then I'm blind.
Yeah.
My mother is an exceptional woman because she's battled so much and still like standing, even without the
pain.
Still standing. And so, like, I just thank God that I still have a mom that I can cry to laughly. That's it. But they said that you can look at your parents to see what you'll be like when you get older. If that's what I'm like when I get older, praise God.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. I have one of the best mothers in the world.
Amen.
Yvette, I gotta go with you. I think my mom was the best. But I knew your mother too, though. But my mom just recently passed, and I'm gonna share this brief story with you. My mom, I did some terrible things in my life. Terrible things. But she never did give up on me. And I'm gonna tell you this one story. I drove and used to get DUIs for years. Didn't have a license for 15 years. But I'm gonna tell you what a mother loved, girl. I seen a car I wanted. My mom knew I didn't have no license, and she still bought that car for me.
Uh-huh.
And then, here's the thing, you know how you can disappoint your mom in things that you do, and the way you say things, and you start being a disappointment to the family, but your mom never do give up on you. She stuck with you side by side. I did over 10 years in prison. My mom never did give up on me. That's a real mother. That's a real mother. She know when to love you, but she know when to put the rod on you. But all at the same time, she instilled in you what it turned out to be. It ain't how you start, but it's how you finish.
Oh, yeah.
Well, she orchestrated this for us to get
I'm another one of her daughter. I don't usually come here, but I came here today.
Praise God. We are lucky. But then we wanted to also recognize Mom's mom, our grandmother, who was the matriarch of our family. And we lived with her pretty much throughout our life. And she was here at this church and guided all of us through, along with our mother. And we continue to bless that memory. But Mom, we are so blessed that you are still with us today. And we're gonna do all we can. Mom is an only child, but she had 10 of us.
8 girls and 2 boys.
And she spoiled as a young girl. But we're going to keep on spoiling until God says, thank you.
Hallelujah.
All right.
Amen. God bless you.
Yes, sir. I just want to say, my mother, I missed a bit, 34 years since my brother passed away. And I used to tell her, I hear my mother's voices on Sunday. My mother, she sung gospel. She kept that away from us. And there's nine of us. So, you know, I come here to hear the word. I don't come here to come and say, I just come for the word.
Bless your heart. All right. All right.
This is what I grew up in. And as I chose my life, I chose my life. That's just what I want.
Bless your heart. Thank you for sharing.
I would just like to take a moment to give honor to my mom. Everybody knows Rose. My mother has so many different layers. It amazes me. Throughout the course of my life, I've seen my mother be a freedom fighter, fighting for justice for everybody. I've seen my mother be a pastor. I've seen my mother deal with children and youth. So she was not just my mother. She was a mother right. to the community. Yeah. And I would also like to give honor to who I call Mama Gladden, because even with my daughter, she's grandma. You know, she doesn't change. She's the same loving person that she has always been. She still calls me daughter, and I still call her mom. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that. And I also want to give honor to the people in my children's lives that might not be biological parents, but like Claudine. Claudine has never missed none of my children's birthdays, Christmas, holidays. She loves on them. She supports them. She loves them. Miss Mac just jumps in and helps guide my children, and I appreciate that. I appreciate my church family. I appreciate you might not have children, but my children are y'all children. Amen. 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 Amen.
There's one child that you claim, but I thought she claimed Pastor.
She does.
That's why Mary didn't mention my name, Pastor.
I forgot about Pam. Yes, y'all. Pam. Kevin LaFay King is my child's mama, y'all. Pam, she provides everything. I forgot Pam was sitting back there, but she does. She is just a phenomenal godmother, and I wouldn't trade Pam for the world.
That's about it. Anyone else? And let me say how grateful I am for those who invited persons, family, friends to be with you today and share this special day of Mother's Day. Those who invited someone and you're here with your mother, would you stand and just let us know who you are? Yeah. I heard what you said. I don't come here where you can start coming. Thank you for being here today. Yes, sir.
Yes, happy Mother's Day, y'all. Brought my mother with me.
Amen.
When you were going to bring your mother today, you brought about 50 other people. Amen. Glad to have you today, everyone. By the way, Miss Claudine, I thought I saw her stand. Yes,
I just
wanted
to say,
oh,
bless. We are to have my mom with us. She is the sweetest person. She's just the best. She's simply the best. Mirror, mirror on the wall. Who's the fairest of them all?
All right.
The first guy you think you see is my mama, Mama Tiny.
I hate to think what would have happened if I had not recognized her and called on her today after she had worked on that speech. Did I see? I thought I saw someone else.
Pam?
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Everybody, have a wonderful day. I just want to say, my mom. Just like a young man, no matter what I did, she was there for me. She never put me down. She never said anything bad. So, but she's just always been a really
awesome,
supportive mom. And I remember when she first gave her life to the Lord, I was about 14, so she's been saved for a long time. So whatever she did, that's what I want to do. Amen. If she was in church dancing, I'm like, Lord, I'm going to dance. If she would read her Bible, would fast, whatever she did, I would do it. So I wanted to do it. So I remember she would be on the phone and she would be talking. And so I would try to eavesdrop. And when I was going eavesdrop, the only thing I ever heard coming out of my mama's house was the, I thought about was the word of God. That's all I ever heard. I never heard her gossip. You know, I never heard her just, you know, speak bad or ill of anybody. And she always said that, she said, let me tell you something. You got to whoop in that church and play. You either say it or you not. She said, you better get up in that church talking about that big girl of
you. Right.
You know you ain't saved. And so I understood what it meant to have a relationship with the Lord. What it meant to be holy. And so, you know, this is what I always say. If you got a mom that loves the Lord and gives
yes. blessings,
you got everything.
Amen. Amen.
Can leave you about riches and material stuff. If she can leave your inheritance, which is Jesus, you got everything you need.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Who was you took your hand up? I'm sorry, who was it? Mike. Okay. Kim. Gotcha. Kim?
I just wanted to say happy Mother's Day to my mom. I just want to say thank you for supporting me in everything that I do in college, in my personal life. Thank you. And also to the other women in my life, Benita, my aunt, and Miss Wendy, she's my aunt as well, yes. My girl to my mom, too. Just thank you to all of you.
Praise God.
All right.
Forget all the mothers that's in
the hospital. Amen. Amen. Good point. Amen. Certainly our prayers go out to them. And we thank y'all for sharing that with us. Amen. And I appreciate the part about, don't you be up there playing in church and playing. You better get to know the Lord. Can you stay that again? No, that's okay. I hope we got it. Amen. And of course, I don't think I ought to tell you how I feel about my mother. I think most of you have some idea, at least anyway. But my mother had a great impact on my life. She had tremendous influence in my life. And I'm grateful to God for my mother and her faithfulness in raising us. And she was, you know, kind of like your mother. She made sure we were in church. And then she would ask us what the preacher preaches. Y'all folks ever ask y'all that? What the preacher preach about today? So we try to remember at least one thing, you know. And you were always safe if you said either Jesus or love. You were always good. Amen. But we thank the Lord for your presence here today and for these young people up here. They're going to get ready to come back and sing. Amen. Everybody say it with me. Sir, we would see Jesus. Come on, is there any word from the Lord? Look at your neighbor, wake them up, tell them there is a word. Amen. Let's welcome all of our Facebook, YouTube friends and followers. We thank you always for joining us here at First Baptist Church every Sunday. May God bless you. Come on, First Baptist. That's true, our gratitude. Amen. Amen. Our choir is going to sing. We thank God for these young people. Amen. All right, ladies. I will love the hills of mine.
Come on, bless the Lord real good for these young people. Amen. Again, thank y'all for sharing those wonderful Mother's Day expressions of love. And I want to encourage you to just do that on a regular basis with your mother if you're blessed enough to still have your mother with you. And for those of us who our mother has gone on to be with the Lord, we're grateful. Yes. And for memory. And all of us, our mothers have left something with us and in us. And what a blessing that is. We want to invite your attention to 2 Kings in chapter number 4. 2 Kings in chapter number 4. And I'm going to look at verses 18 through 30. But let me look at those just a little bit later. And we appreciate that was read in our hearing. Maybe not 18, but the scripture we had posted. And we appreciate that so much. Amen. I want to talk about, again, love that fades not away. And many of you have already expressed many of the thoughts that we intend to talk about, intend to share with you. We thank God for Deacon Sheets. I think he probably, I don't know how he got it in my head and knew what I was going to say, but I guess we just understand mothers that way. Amen. Because when it comes to the love of a mother, that is something that there is no other comparison. Only the love of God excels the love of a mother. And I don't care what anybody say or what kind of mother you think you have or that you think you had. Mothers are special, and I believe that God made them that way. I believe that God put something in them that's not in everybody else. As a matter of fact, there are many who do not have children, but they have a mother's heart. Amen. God put something in them as well, and they do well to help our children, to teach them and instill in them primarily through example the way that we ought to live and the way in which we ought to grow up. Amen. And the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So when I look at the love of a mother and Ron, I may not have done everything you did or gone to the extent that you did, or I may have gone beyond what you did. But one thing that I do know is that my mother never gave up on me. My mother never gave up on me. And I'm glad. I said I'm glad because since mama did not give up on me, that did something to me. It helped me work harder to make sure that I did not disappoint my mother. It brought to my attention how much she really loved me. Because, you know, when folk put up with certain things, that right there can tell you that it ain't nothing but the love of God. I said it's nothing but the love of God. And I'm so happy that I had an opportunity to experience that mother's love. And I might as well go ahead and tell you, I'm still riding on it right now. I said, I'm still riding on it right now. I still feel the love and I still feel the impact of the love. And I'm glad that God brought me to this scripture. It's kind of an unusual Mother's Day scripture. But then I believe that it really hits the nail on the head. Because it talks about a mother. A woman, let me back up. Talks about a woman that the Bible describes as a Shunammite woman. That was not identified by name. But just by her location. Where she was from. It's kind of like saying she was a Gainesville woman. She was an Atlanta woman. Amen. And while names are important, God is more concerned about our character and about our content. And God does not always identify people in the Bible by their name. But sometimes he identifies them by their character, by their location, or by their situation. Amen. This woman, when the prophet of God, Elijah, when he was going about doing the work of God,
and he would generally pass by their house. This was a married woman, and she invited him in, invited him into her home. It was kind of like a stopover, a rest area. As a matter of fact, she convinced her husband to build an extra room onto the house so that when the man of God would come that way, I got to tell you that I'm not sure that I would have been convinced of that, to build an extra room onto my house so another man can stop over and rest himself. But I believe that when you are in tune with the Holy Spirit of God, that God will lead you and that God will guide you to do some things that will benefit you that you may not necessarily agree with. Amen. Here's what I'm saying is there are times that we've got to get out of our flesh. I said we got to get out of our fleshly way of thinking. Get out of our fleshly way of acting and allow God to have his way. And so they were very kind to the man of God. And they provided him a rest place, a place where he could stop and refresh himself. And they would feed him. They would take care of him. And the man of God was appreciative. But after a certain time going back and forth, he finally stopped long enough to say to the woman, "You know, y'all have been mighty kind to me."
Yes, sir.
Amen. Don't you forget when people are kind to you, when people are nice to you. Don't you forget about them and don't fail to say thank you. Don't fail to express your gratitude.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And man of God says, "You know, y'all been mighty kind to me, and you've done well to invite me in and provide a place for me to stay." He says, "In return, I know I don't have to do anything for you, but in return, what is it that I might be able to help you with?" He says, "You've been a tremendous help to me, and I want to know what can I do for you?" It was almost like Elijah was saying that I have a connection. I got a hookup with somebody. I know somebody down at the bank. I know somebody over at the grocery store. How can I help you? How can I repay your kindness? And I'm glad to see people like that who don't just take the goods and run.
Amen.
But stop long enough, like the leper did. Stop long enough to come back and say thank you. And so he asked, and she said, "Well, I've not been able to have a child yet. I'm barren, and I've always wanted a child, and I've not been able to have a child. And I would like to know if you could put a word in for me that God might grant me a child." And she cautioned him and said, "Now, don't play with me. Don't fool me now. If you can't do anything for me, just say you can't, and we'll leave it at that." And she says, I don't want to be misled, and I don't want to be deceived, and I don't want to be disappointed, but if you could do something, I would like to have a baby one day. I'd like to have my own child." And the Bible goes on to tell us that God granted her request. And sometimes, every now and then, when God answers our prayers, things can sometimes happen to then even make us doubt God and doubt the power of God. The boy had gone to the field with his father. The Bible says in King James, it says when the child was grown. But I believe that it really talked about when the child had grown up. When he had gotten a little bit older, and then his daddy would take him to the field and teach him how to work. Amen. His daddy would have him tag along so that he could go out there and learn how to take responsibility. Where he could learn how to work with his hands. And one day, while they were out there working in the hot sun, the boy says, "I got a terrible headache." He said, "I got a terrible headache. My head is hurting badly. I got a terrible headache." And you know how us fathers are. You know how we fathers are. The daddy called for the servant.
All right.
And said, "Take him to his mama."
Yeah.
Amen. Brothers, come on, don't act like you don't know the drill. When the child comes to you in trouble, when the child has an issue, go talk to your mama.
Yeah.
Amen. Come on, brothers, you know how it is. When you got a young baby, crying baby, that works on a schedule, gets up at 2 a.m. Amen. And up for a few hours and just decide to sing a few of those old familiar hymns. And brother nudges the sister. Your baby crying. Amen. So he sends the boy back to his mother. Bible says she takes him in her arms and she's sitting there. I can imagine maybe she was sitting out on the porch and rocking the boy, and then the boy dies. He dies. She has prayed for him. She has asked the prophet of God to help her, to speak on her behalf, to do something that she might have a child. Now she has the child and the child dies. But she doesn't give up there. She doesn't call it a day.
Yeah, that's right.
She doesn't curse God. She remembers. Yeah, watch this now. She remembers the source of her blessing. I remember. It was that pastor that I talked to.
All right.
It was that pastor that assured me that God would help me. And now my son has died. I'm going right back to that same preacher. Come on, you're going to wake up after a while. I'm going back to that same preacher that got a prayer through on my behalf. I'm going back to that same preacher that had a connection with God. And I want to know what took place. I want to know what happened. She went back and she approached the prophet of God and she goes back to ask the prophet of God what's going on. One of his servants tried to stop her. He said, leave her alone.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, he looked up, and when he saw her coming, he said, there come that Shunammite woman.
Yeah.
there she comes. And I don't think he was saying, I wonder what does she want now. But she came in and he said, leave her alone. And she began to share with the man of God that now, and here's how she put it. This is literally how she put it. She said, now, I told you not to fool me.
All right.
I told you don't be playing with me. Listen, brothers, one of the worst things that you and I can do is to play with a woman's feelings and her emotions. Walking on some dangerous ground there. And she said, now I told you, did I not say, don't fool me, don't mislead me, did I not say that to you? And watch what happens now, because this woman has great faith. She has left the dead child back home, and she goes to the man of God. And she says, now you remember what I told you. But when she approached the man of God, watch what she does now. Because the man of God says, and again, I don't think it was like, well, what's wrong now? What do you want now? But he says, is all well?
Yeah.
Everything well? And here's what she says. A dead child at home. And in an act. And in a word of faith, she said, all is well.
Wow. Yes, sir.
Wow. Yes.
Remember what Abraham and Isaac going up the mountain? We going up to worship, and then we coming back. Amen. Amen. We coming back. You got to have that kind of faith.
Yes.
She says, all is well.
Yes.
And she goes on to tell him, though, that the son has died, and the man of God sends his servant, says, take my staff and take it back there and lay it on the boy and see if the boy will recover.
All right.
The servant goes back, and here's what the woman tells him, tells the prophet, the man of God. She says to him, now, you can send the servant, you know, these are my words, but I'm expressing her thoughts. You can send your servant all you want to, but I ain't going nowhere without you. No, you are my source. You know the Lord. You can get a prayer through. And the same God, listen now, the same God that gave me the son can give him back to me. I don't know about that power your servant got, but I know you got some power. I don't know whether your servant can get a prayer through or not, but I know you can get a prayer through. I ain't going nowhere without you. And sometimes it's that way, Deacon. Sometimes it's that way. And you just have to face it. When folks send for the pastor, they ain't trying to feel you when you send the deacon. I mean, ain't nothing against the deacon. They know the law too. But she says, now, you can send your servant down there to lay your staff on her, do whatever you want to do. But I ain't going nowhere without you.
All right.
Amen. Amen. That remember when I'm not going to let you go till you bless me? And that's what she was telling me. I ain't leaving you until you bless me. Come on, somebody. Because I believe that she saw it this way. You and I got in this situation together, and we're getting out of it together. Amen. God sent the child on your word. And I believe on your word, God will return the child to me. So the prophet says, let's go then.
All right.
And he goes back with the woman. Let me read the scripture and then we'll preach. Don't get scared. You'll be out in plenty of time to get to the restaurant, okay? Watch it. Here it is. And I'm going to read through it very quickly. I've basically given it to you already. It says, when the child was grown, I'm at verse 18, it fell on a day that he went out to his father to the reapers. He went with his father to work. He said unto his father, my head, my head, my head. He said to a lad, he says, carry him to his mother. And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. She went up immediately. And I watched this. She went up, laid him on the bed of the man of God in his room, in the room that they had built onto the house for the prophet of God. She didn't take him and put him in her bed. She laid him in. That is power. That is the power of faith. You remember what he said? If I could but touch the hem of his garment. If you could just throw your handkerchief on me. Anybody feel me? That when you get around people that's so filled with the Holy Ghost, got so much power emanating from them, that all you want, if I could just get in the same room, if I could just get close. And there's something about the move of God. When you get close, you can feel something on the inside. Amen. Hallelujah be to God. Listen to what he says here in the word of God. It says, and she went, laid him on the bed of the man of God, shut the door upon him, and went out. And she called her husband and said, send me. Watch this now. She's wasting no time. Send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses, that I may run to the man of God, that I may run to the man of God. Listen. And she says, and come again. I'll be back. Let me go find the man of God and I'll be back. And he says, what are you going to see the man of God? And it's kind of like him saying, today ain't Sunday. That's kind of like what he said. Today ain't Bible study. He said, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath.
All right.
And she said, it. Watch what she says. It shall be well.
Yes, sir.
Lord.
Yes.
Listen to me, people of God. Make up your mind. Make a determination in your mind that whatever you attempt that is pleasing in the sight of God, that your efforts will not be in vain. I'm going after something and I am not going to fail. I'll be back. I'm going on a mission that I shall accomplish. I am not coming back empty-handed. I am not coming back disappointed. I'm going where I know that success can be assured. Amen. So she says, I'm going. Baby, don't worry. I'll be back. It shall be well. And then verse 24, then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, now you drive and go forward and don't you let up one iota. You better drive that mule or that horse or whatever it was. You better drive it till its tongue hang out. You better not slow down for anything. Amen. She said, go forward. Slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. If I don't tell you to stop, don't you stop for anything. So she went, came unto the man of God, to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her fall, that he said to Gehazi, his servant, behold, yonder is that Shulamite woman. Run now, he says, run to meet her. Pray thee, meet her. Say unto her, it is well with thee. Is it well with thy husband? Listen now, he's asking specific questions. Is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with the child? She answered, it is well. Dead child at home.
Yeah.
It is well.
Wow.
And when she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet. But Gehazi came near to thrust her away. And the man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed.
Yeah.
The man of God recognizes that this is not a social call.
Yeah. Yeah.
He recognizes that the woman has some issue going on in her life. He recognizes that her soul is vexed, that something is going on within her. And here's what he says, but God has not revealed it to me yet what's going on. He says, I know something's wrong, but I don't know what it is.
Yes,
something is going on with you. I just don't know quite what it is just yet. So he says in verse number 27, and when she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet. Gehazi came near, thrust away. The man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her. And the Lord hath hid it from me and had not told me. Then she said, that's what she said. Now, didn't I tell you? That is right there. Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me?
Yes.
Don't you mess with me. Don't you play with me, boy. See, did I not tell you that? Then he said to Gehazi, gird up thy loins and take, listen, thy staff and thine hand, go thy way if thou meet. And he told him, now you go and don't you stop for anybody. Don't be stopping along the road, chit-chatting with nobody. You just keep going. And if any salute you, don't even answer. Just keep going. And he says, and lay my staff upon the face of the child. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. I am not going anywhere without you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he arose, and he followed her. He followed her. Again, there's something about a mother that at the very moment that all circumstances suggest, that the situation suggests, that you quit, that you give up. When you look at the picture, it is clear that this is an insurmountable challenge. This is something that is facing you that you're not likely to overcome. This woman, this mother, in spite of those odds, go preach, Pastor. In spite of this situation, she still had faith. She still believed in God. Left a dead son home, but she's going back to the same one that connected her with God. And says, something went wrong. I don't know how it happened, why it happened, but something went wrong, and I had the child, all right, all that went well, but now he's dead. The child is gone. So the man of God gets up and he goes, so I want you to understand something about this woman of God, and let me give you four or five things real quick and get us out of here, because this is a love that fadeth not. In other words, this is a love that does not dissipate. This is a love that does not lose any of its power. This is a love that is at a certain level and will always be at that level. This is a love that your mother loves you just as much as she loved you when you were a little baby and they thought you were cute. And even after your transformation, she still loves you. In spite of what you've done, hear me, in spite of what you've become, she still loves you. Even oftentimes, in spite of how you hurt her, how you disappoint her, she still loves you. That's the power of love of a mother. It's nothing to play with. You know, I hear people talk about you don't want to bother the chicks of an eagle when the mother eagle around, and you don't want to bother the cubs when the lioness is around. And you ain't seen nothing till you see a mama. You mess with her child. I say you mess with her child. Amen. So as we look at this scripture, what do we gain out of this scripture? We see in this woman the character of a caring woman, the character of a caring mother. This woman has a certain character that holds her together, a certain character that connects her with other people of God. She has a kind of character that she can talk to people and they listen. Yes, sir. She has the kind of character where she's respected by those in the community. She has, well, watch this now, because you may have overlooked it. She has the kind of character. And I wish I could just preach on this section and get to the rest of it over the next two or three weeks. But she has the, watch this now. She has the kind of character that her husband trusts completely in her.
Amen.
I mean, come on now.
Yeah.
Baby, build a room onto the house.
Yeah.
We might even talk about the husband doing Father's Day. But watch this man. He trusts her.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to stay there a minute anyway. Listen. You cannot blame the other person for your mistrust. This was a husband that saw in his woman the kind of character that would help him realize.
Yes, yes.
And it wasn't about him. Because some of us think it's about,
yeah,
I ain't worried about her. She ain't going nowhere. And you don't even know she's tried to leave five times.
Good God.
All right. You get home, check next to the bed. You'll see a little suitcase there.
Jesus.
Check and see if it's got anything in it. This man, baby, we're building a room on for the man of God.
Yeah.
Okay, sweetheart.
That's right.
Because he knows her. He ain't talking about his power. I'm not worried, sweetheart. That'll be fine, because I know I look good enough. I know I'm handsome enough. And I know I've been treating you right and all that. So I ain't worried about you looking at another man. No, that ain't got nothing to do with you.
Amen.
Because you could be the finest thing that ever walked the face of the earth and she'd still look at somebody else. It ain't about you, it's about her character. Let me try it one more time. I say, it ain't about you, character. It's about her character. Amen. And that's the character of a caring mother. Are you hearing me today? And that's why she expresses that love that never fails and never fades away. Secondly, I want you to understand is this woman, this mother, she had the kind of patience that endured painful situations.
Yes, sir. Amen. Yes, sir.
Out of all that they did, they were hurting the whole while. They loved. They forgave. They worked with you. And they were patient. And they were praying, trusting the Lord that you would come around. But they were in pain, in anguish through the whole process. They did it in spite of their pain. A mother will work through pain of taking care of you, putting up with you, but keep on loving you. Because through that love, they have learned to patiently endure painful situations. And really, if it goes on long enough, it'll become evident because it'll start showing. They're going to hang in there as long as they can, but it'll start showing in their face. It'll start showing in their demeanor. It'll start showing in their movement. That's only natural. Amen. That's only natural. But she endures all of that because of you and because of me. She patiently endures the pain. How can I say it? She patiently endures the pain associated with your misbehavior. Amen. She's good when you ain't.
All right. That's it. That's right.
She's hurting when you don't even care. She's burdened down while you running footloose and fancy free. She's up all night worried about you when you ain't worried about nothing. You just out there doing your own thing. She endures the pain of the failures, of the disappointments. She bears the burden of that pain on her shoulder, on her back, in her heart, because she loves you. That's the love that does not fade away. That's the love that's always there. Always there. And listen, that mother, she has compassion for the imperfect. Amen. And I heard what you were saying, you know, y'all talk about your mother, and I'm glad you clarified it. My mother's the best mother in the world to me. See, once you clarify, we ain't got to fight now. My mama, no, we don't have to go through that. Amen. But she's the best to me. Listen, and my mother, now your mother may not do this, but my mother, they listen, a loving and a caring mother, she has a certain compassion even for the imperfect. Let me please try to make that clear to you, because some of us grow up seeking. Now you may have to do this with your daddy, but not with your mama. We grow up seeking the approval of our parents, doing things that we don't want to do, doing things we don't like to do, but because that's what they like, that's what pleases them. So we try to do it. In other words, we live their life instead of our life. But a loving mother would tell you, now daddy got son, no, you getting out there on that football field, boy, and just cause you couldn't run, just cause it was your lifelong dream to be a doctor, you can't force your child to become a doctor, you can't force your daughter to be a doctor just cause that's what you wanted.
Right.
Are you hearing me?
Yes,
In other words, here's what I'm saying. A loving mother accepts you just as you are. As you are. And I don't know how to do it. I do my best to try to instill this in young people and adults alike that I don't know who you're trying to please, and I don't know who you're trying to impress, but you really good just as you are. You don't really need all that. As a matter of fact, sometimes you've been messed up the best part of you. Amen. And that's the good thing about your mama. Your mama, she ain't gonna complain a whole lot because you're my child. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect. You know, and she has that compassion for the imperfect. For the imperfect. Darrell is not here. My boy's not here. He's up at the Kentucky Derby. I think he's on the way back home now. But this is what happened when the youngest child was born, and she had this deformity, what most of you call a cleft lip, and she's been having to go through surgery after surgery. Such a sweetheart, so courageous. She's been through, I think now, maybe 6 or 7 different surgeries and still got a couple more to go. But when she was first born, her mother was there with her. And my son, Darrell, now don't tell him that, this is just between you and me. My son, he couldn't take what he saw. He couldn't take it. He left the hospital because he couldn't take it. And he had to sort of gather himself. Mama's still there with the baby. And he went back. And they love that baby. She's just as smart as she can be. And she's such a sweetheart, so courageous. And but he didn't know how to handle it at first. What would you do? What do you think you would do if, you know, God forbid, if you had a child and your child was born, you know, with some disability, some disorder or something like that? Not everybody can take it.
Right, that's right.
Not everybody can deal with
it. That's right, man, that's right.
But that mother... It's going to be right there. Good, bad, or otherwise. That mother is going to be right there. I don't care what you go through. I don't care what you have to endure. That mother is going to be right there because she has that compassion for the imperfect. Knowing that you're not all of that. You know, you're not all of that in a bag of chips. You might be a biscuit or something. I don't know. But she loves you anyhow. And then here's what I want to close with, is we talk about this love that is so amazing love and such amazing grace and such patience with us. This mother exhibited, she demonstrated, and this is something that all of us need to make sure that we have. She had, listen now, think about her journey from the time the boy was sent home to her. And every mother feels like whatever ails the child that they can fix it.
Right.
Yeah. So you got to deal with that if you fail. And, you know, because every mother feels that way. Come on, baby, come to mama. You know, with your 45-year-old self, come on to mama. And they feel like they can fix it. They feel like they can fix you. This woman, and please get this, this woman had persistent faith. And I'm talking about faith that doesn't give up, faith that doesn't quit, faith that doesn't back down, no matter what it looks like, no matter what the odds are. She had, listen now, she had persistent faith that produced favor. Knock, and it shall be open. Ask, and you shall receive. The Bible tells us if you are persistent in your, I ain't quitting, I'm not going to give up, and you, my friend, are not going to talk me out of my blessing. She had faith.
Yes, sir.
Put your child in the man of God's room. went and found the man of God.
Yes.
Faith. And watch what's happening, because I believe in this process, her faith is not diminishing, but her faith is increasing.
Yes.
As she goes,
yes.
She's getting stronger and stronger in her faith.
Yes.
And her faith produced favor.
Yes, Lord.
You have to go ahead and read the rest of the story, but the boy was recovered. God spared life. God rewarded her persistence. He rewarded her faith. And you can do whatever you want to do, but if I'm in a situation that I know I can't handle, you watch, when the boy died, the mama didn't do anything to try to bring the boy back. She immediately took him and put him in the prophet's room. Are you hearing me? And you can do what you want to do, however you want to do it. But I'm gonna trust in the Lord. I'm gonna have faith. I'm not gonna give up. I mean, I'm gonna labor in prayer, and as you go, that's what faith is. You gotta exercise your faith. You gotta use it, and then the more you use it, the stronger it gets. As she went from one level to another level, her faith did not diminish. You know, in other words, when she got down the road a bit, she didn't, well, I'm just tired. I'm just going. No. It grew stronger and stronger and stronger. And here's what God does. When you have persistent faith, God gives you favor. Favor, this is just one of the descriptions. Favor, listen, favor is when something happens that had no reason for happening, that wasn't supposed to happen, that there was no way it could happen, no way that man could do it. But God gives us favor. Unmerited. Favor. And it just means that God will ignite some things on your behalf. That God will cause some things to be restored to you, to be returned to you. And even when God doesn't give you back exactly what you lost, He gives you something better. He gives you something bigger. Hallelujah be to God. Rewards our faith. When we are persistent in our faith, God gives us favor. Don't give up, my friend. Stand on your feet. Thank God for our mothers. Let's learn a lesson. Because mothers don't have a monopoly on it. Amen. We can learn too. We can learn from our mothers how to be faithful to God and how to receive the favor of God. I said, God will also bless us. That's just what comes with a child of God. That when you allow Christ to come on the inside, He will develop that kind of character in you that will strengthen you, that will strengthen your faith, that in the face of adversity, God moves on my behalf. Come on, somebody ought to be praising the Lord by now. Don't you give up. I said, don't you quit. I said, God, He rewards our faithfulness. He rewards our faith when we show God that our trust is in you.
Thank you, Lord.
That's why when you don't make the team, just going out to the court anyway.
All right.
Watch the other ones play.
Just
going out there on the field anyway. Watch others. If they told you, no, you can't make the golf team, you can't make the tennis team, just go out there anyway.
Yeah.
They tell you, well, no, you don't have the job, just stop by there every now and then anyway. Here's what I want to do. I want to go as far as I need to go. Even if I have to get on God's last nerve.
All right. I hear you. I hear you. Yes. Yes.
I generally, and I'm grateful to God, I generally find if that's something I say I want, something I say I want to do, I generally get it. Because I don't stop till I do.
All right. Amen.
I'm persistent. I don't care how many times. And I tell people up front, I says, I don't want to let this go right now. I said, that's fine. I don't. I said, I'm a patient man. I said, but you need to know that I'm going to probably be calling you every day. And you also need to know I don't have no sense of time. I could call you at 5:30 in the morning. I'm going to work to get on your last nerve.
All right.
Until you see the light.
Yes, yes.
And say, here it is. You see it. You read it in the Bible. You know, folk just, woman just pressed upon God and to God, you know, the man of God, the man of God. So, somebody, give that woman whatever she wants. Give it to her.
Yes, sir.
That's what I want. I ain't mad at you. You get mad at me all you want to. Get an attitude. I don't care as long as I get what I want. You gotta, I believe that I can get what I go after.
Yes.
That's why generally I get it, because I believe I can.
Yeah.
I have faith that God will grant it.
Yes.
I pray and I leave it to God to grant it. Whatever you need in your life, my friend. First of all, you need salvation. You need the Lord.
Yes.
God will give it to you. He's already provided it for you.
Yes.
Whatever your needs are, God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Gracious God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the presence and power of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts. And Father, if there's one in the house today, if there are those who are out of the ark of safety, God, it is our prayer that you would speak, that you would touch, that they might come before it's everlasting too late. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The doors of the church open. Jesus says, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your soul. If there's one.